This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We come together with the people of God on the first day of the week in praise and thanksgiving to our Lord and King. To begin the week in mutual support of one another as the body of Christ, the Church. To begin the week renewing our resolve to build God's kingdom upon this earth for His glory and honor. All praise the mighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I'd like to thank all those who filled in last week. Chris Harrison for bringing us the message. Liz for suddenly realizing that she has to do this live streaming and all that, and being able to see what was going on. I'm almost there. I'm still within that 10 days. That's why I'm still wearing the mask. Sharon is also recovering at home this morning. It hit her a little harder than it hit me. So anyway, I'm glad to be back. Our opening hymn is "This Is Amazing Grace." Let's stand and sing.
The psalm for today is Psalm 76, verses 1 through 6. In Judah God is known, whose name is great as in Israel, whose abode has been established in Salem, whose dwelling place is in Zion.
There God broke the flashing arrows, the shield, the sword, and the weapons of war.
You are glorious, more majestic than the everlasting mountains. All the soldiers were unable to use their hands.
At your review of God of Jacob, both rider and horse and stern.
Our next hymn is Rock of Ages.
Thank you.
faith we profess with the Apostles' Creed, let us join in this historic confession of our faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven. He sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Let us go before the throne of grace in our prayer of confession. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart.
We have failed to be an obedient church.
We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Here is good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God.
Amen.
As a forgiven people, let us greet each other with signs of reconciliation. Harvest has come in, and He's got grain and stored in his storehouse. In fact, he's got more grain than he can store in his storehouse. And so he thinks, you know what? I've got plenty. I'm going to just build, tear these down, build bigger storehouses, store all that grain, and then I'm just going to take it easy for the rest of my life. I'm just going to relax. I'm going to eat, drink, and be merry. And just basically retire. Well, the word retire is actually not in the Bible. And the Lord says to him, you fool, tonight your life will be required of you. And then what's all this wealth that you gain, what's all this that's going to gather, that's going to do for you? God is in charge, and he knows the times of the things that's going to happen. And we still have a mission to do. We still have a purpose on this earth. And we're not really called to retire. Like I said, the word retire is not a title. As close as it comes is at age 50, a temple priest is supposed to stop doing the ceremony and then teach the younger priests how to do it. But it's not to retire. We have a lifelong mission to always make disciples of all nations, to continue to bring the good news of the gospel to those who need to hear it. We have a continuous mission that never calls us to retire, to just sit back and do nothing, because we're always called to build God's kingdom. Now, the song is actually going to tie into the sermon. I'll mention something about later. It's the lyrics are Rock of Ages. The tune is Rock and Rock.
Old Testament lesson today is from Isaiah, the second chapter, verses 12 through 18. For the Lord of hosts has a day against all that is proud and lofty, against all that is lifted up, and it shall be brought low, against all the cedars of Lebanon, lofty and lifted up, and against all the oaks of Bashan, against all the lofty mountains, and against all the uplifted hills, against every high tower, and against every fortified wall, against all the ships of Tarshish, and against all the beautiful craft. And the haughtiness of man shall be humbled, and the lofty pride of men shall be brought low. And the Lord alone will be exalted in that day, and the idols shall utterly pass away. The New Testament is from Luke 14th chapter, verses 7 through 11. Now he told a parable to those who were invited, when he noticed how they chose the places of honor, saying to them, when you are invited by someone to a wedding feast, do not sit down in a place of honor, lest someone more distinguished than you be invited by him. And he who invited you both will come and say to you, give up your place to this person, and then you will begin with shame to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit in the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he may say to you, friend, move up higher. Then you will be honored in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Before we sing, I wanted to just say a few words. We are remembering today is September 11th, and 21 years ago was an infamous day in our history, and I am teaching history at Junction High School, and it's kind of weird now. For the past few years, I've been teaching this to children who were not even born yet, and so many of them have heard from firsthand primary sources about that day. And we covered it Friday in my class. We stopped what we were doing and we were covering it. And one of the things that really had them watch some things and share their reflections, and the thing that was really brought out was how in a horrible, horrible time, God worked his miracles through everyday people who stood up and helped and did what was needed, whether they had an official title or whether they were just there to lend a helping hand. And so before we begin, my favorite verse, we're doing a couple of my favorites. The last one is a prayer, which you're going to help us sing, because God does command in 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. And the favorite verse, because heroes come in many forms, oh beautiful, for heroes proved in liberating strife, who more than self their country loved, and mercy more than life.
Oh, my God.
Over this past week, we've been fighting this disease. We are continuing our sermon series on the Psalms of Asaph. This is Psalms 73 to 83. And the word psalm comes from the Greek word psalmoi. And literally what it means is the lyrics that accompany the music. They're literally psalm sheets, is what they are. So the word psalm is a practical description of the words that we have, what they are. They're lyrics, the psalms. But in the Hebrew scripture, the book that we call psalms is called Tehillim. And the word Tehillim means praises. These are not just song lyrics, but they're praises to God. The words of faithful men and women expressing themselves before God in song. These are ordinary people who face the same situations, the same problems we find ourselves in. And they have days when things go well. They have things that when days don't go well. The communities they live in also have collective successes and collective failures. But whether it's personal or communal, the ups and downs of life are sometimes find themselves happy, sometimes sad, sometimes thankful, sometimes angry, sometimes in peace, sometimes in despair. But through it all, no matter what, these faithful men and women still lift up their voices and tell Him and praise to God. And He leads us in these songs of praise. The words of the psalms are human words. There are words back to God. They express the human emotions, the wide variety of human emotions. We connect to these words when we strive toward holiness and all our joys and our sorrows and everything in between. The Holy Spirit has given us these words so that we may have a voice no matter what, no matter what situation we find ourselves, when words escape us, when we don't know how to pray, we can find a psalm, we can find a tehillim, a praise that brings us into God's presence. It reminds us that we have not been orphaned, that we have not been left alone, that our God still watches over us, our God still stands with us. Through everything. One of the traditional spiritual disciplines is called praying the psalms. And when you just read the psalm as a prayer to God and let that praise take over whatever situation you find yourselves in. And there are, like I said, the whole gamut of human emotions is expressed in the psalms. Some people talk about Psalm 22, the guy's angry if he's angry at God. But God can take it, and sometimes we find ourselves. Psalm 100, that beautiful psalm, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Praying the psalms gives us a voice in that conversation that we have with God. Our relationship with God is not a one-way street, it's a two-way street, where we respond and He speaks to us, go back and forth. They transcend time, language, location, culture, as each of these psalms brings our soul to the presence of God. One who loves you more than you can possibly comprehend. Today's song of Asaph is Psalm 75. Now, we can't tell when it's written. It's one of those that doesn't matter what the context is. It's something that fits the world wherever we are. The world Asaph is not really that different than the world we have today. The Prologomena tells us that instructs the choir master to set this tune to "Do Not Destroy." Now, unfortunately, we don't have the tunes. We don't have musical notation. Did not evolve until about the 13th century. Historically, tunes and lyrics are written separately. The idea that tunes and lyrics go together is kind of a modern phenomenon. Carving arose with recorded music. You can blame Thomas Edison for that. But you'll notice that even as we go through the hymns, you'll notice that we'll have some hymns in which there'll be, in the back of the hymnal, there's an index of tunes, and you'll see that several hymns will be set to the same tune. And the opposite occurs. Sometimes we've got the lyrics set to more than one tune. But it's pretty common, isn't it, throughout history. One of the example, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name, it's on is 154 and 155 of the hymnal, two different tunes. The great reformer Martin Luther, he chose a drinking song as the tune for his hymn, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. And if you listen to it, you can kind of hear it. You kind of get, you can always picture these people at these benches in the beer garden with their signs waving back and forth, and they're singing, Ein Feistiger gibt unser Gott und Göttin wir unwaffen. Had to look that up, it's only German anyway. Now Luther was criticized this for bringing the songs of Satan into the church. And Luther's response was, well, why should the devil have all the good tunes? Our national anthem is set to a drinking song, to answer on in heaven. So Asa begins, he sets this to the tune, do not destroy it. We don't know what it is. And he begins with a word of praise. We praise you, God. We praise you, for your name is near. People tell of your wonderful deeds. God is always with his children. And so we do praise him. We give him our thanks and praise. We give him our thanksgiving. He's blessed us beyond blessing. And we're to bear witness to all the good gifts that he's given us. Given to us as a whole and given to each one of us as individuals. We recount his good and perfect gifts, not just to remind ourselves, but to remind others of the good that we have that far exceeds our troubles. So Asaph begins with praise. So what are these wonderful deeds for which Asaph leads us in praise? You say, I choose the appointed time. It is I who judge with equity. When the earth and all its people quake, it is I who hold the pillars firm. Selah. Just a word of diversion here. That word Selah, which you see at the end of some of the lines in the psalm. The only period of music in the Bible that appeared 71 times in the psalm and 3 times in the psalm that's recorded in the back. This word Selah. We're not exactly sure what the word Selah means. It seems to be some sort of musical term. If you're following your Bible, you may notice the word Selah is actually in the text. Sometimes it's actually a footnote to the text. It could be an indication of a musical interlude. We don't know. It could be some sort of filler that you're supposed to put in. Think of the word, you know, deck the halls and bows of Holly. Every other line has 8 laws in it. Giving some of the time to count because there's actually one. But we don't know what the word Selah means, but it's there, and so I just mentioned it in passing. But the verse says, you say, I choose the appointed time. It is I who judge with equity. When the earth and all its peoples quake, it is I who hold the pillars firm. We praise God that he's the one in charge and not us. The job of God is taken, and thankfully I ate it. Sometimes it's hard for us to let go and let God. We have big egos. We want to be in charge. We want to be in the driver's seat. In the 1980s, there was a group called Tears for Fears, and they had a song, Everybody Wants to Rule the World. Well, yeah, we kind of do. We kind of want the world to go our way. We want to know what's going on, and we kind of want to have control. We have a good idea of the way you're supposed to act. We puff ourselves up. We think that we're better than we are. We tend to be overconfident in our own knowledge, our own wisdom, and our own righteousness. Social media does not help. You know, if you ever log into Facebook, what is it always asking? What's on your mind? And unfortunately, too many people put exactly what's on their mind, even when it's crickets. Facebook, anybody can say anything positive or negative or negative or negative. Whether it's true or not, and each like tends to stroke our ego. We like to see that it makes us think we're important. It makes us think that our opinion matters, that we have influence. It's a great temptation in our society. You like to count the likes. I got bad news for you. About half of those are robots. But that's the way it is. We're afraid when we're not in charge. Not being in control frightens. We have seen bad things happen when we're not in charge, when we don't know what's happening. It catches us by surprise. Things are beyond our control. Disasters caused by surprise, threatening our own peace and our security. As we mentioned, this is the 21st anniversary of the 9/11 attacks. And we all know where we were and what we were doing that Tuesday morning. And we all know that how we felt and the insecurity that what was happening when we tried to know that it was one of those traumatic moments when the evil of this fallen world overwhelmed us. In 2 hours, 3,000 people were dead. And it wasn't just an attack on our capital. You know, we kind of think that, well, that's a strategic target. But no, this was just average people. People on airplanes just flying to see relatives. Something that we would do ourselves. It was something that happened to people that no more control the situation than we do. It was a moment when evil shook the earth and his people, the very pillars of this earth. Verse 3, when the earth and its people quake, it is I who hold the pillars. Praise God that he does. Praise God that he brought us through our fear and our anger, and he restored us. As Meredith said, it's now something that our kids read about in history books. The 9/11 attacks were what basically encouraged my son to join the military, serving two tours in Iraq, one in Afghanistan, and one in South Korea. But we are now in a place where laughter and joy is restored. Normal patterns of life, with birthdays, holidays, marriages, laughter, song, and friendship. Praise God that it's he who does hold us in the palm of his hand, who leads us through in times of evil assault. We've gone through a great period of fear in the past 2 years, fearing this disease, and finally caught up with me. I'm reminded of the writings of C.S. Lewis, that great writer, Christian writer through World War II. When the atomic age occurred and they were dealing with the idea that there might be this atomic bomb coming from Russia into England, he said, "Let it find me doing human things. Let it find me having beer with my friends, throwing darts. Let it find me taking care of my child. Let it find me living life." The earth and all its peoples quake. It's God who holds the pillars firm. The pride and fear that tempts us gives rise to false prophets, telling us the appointed times to come. Trying to control, trying to assert, trying to say, "Oh, we've got this figured out. We've got the key." When I was growing up in El Paso, as in the Boy Scouts, we did a lot of camping up in New Mexico. The Lincoln National Forest is about 90 miles north of El Paso. And El Paso, because it's right stuffed in the corner of the state, it's got New Mexico to the north and New Mexico to the south. And it can't grow north because not only has we got a state line, but you also have the Black Sands Missile Range. So the northern city limits of El Paso was pretty well fixed. And so as we would go camping, we would come into town, and right as we got into town, there was this billboard on the side of the church. And I don't remember exactly what it said, but it was something like, "Behold, the day of the Lord is coming," and it had a date. Well, that date would come and go. And then you'd drive by the next time and have a different date. And drive I don't know if that sign's still there, but I wonder what the date is now. That was 40, 50 years ago. We try to be in control. We try to take charge. And we are afraid when we're not. And it's a great temptation that we fear. We want to know what's going on. We give praise to God who selects the appointed times. It's Solomon who reminds us there's a time for everything and every season for activity under heaven. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to uproot, a time to kill, a time to heal. A time to tear down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. We may not understand, but we trust that God knows when the right time is for whatever it is. We know that God holds us in his hands. He works for our good. We know that he wants to bless us. We give praise that it's God who has control of all time. We may be on just in for a ride, but that's okay. We know the one who stands with us. We also give praise that it's God who judges with equity. The same pride and fear that drive us to manipulate the appointed time or tempts us to judge the world by our own standards, to try to reform God into our image, and tell him, well, this is what the way it should be. Paul warns Timothy, for the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn away their ears from the truth and turn aside to myths. That's certainly something that we see in our society. That's certainly something that we see in popular media as people try to define what is good and try to redefine what is evil in ways that God defines us. But it is God who judges with equity. It's God who created us, and God who knows us better than we know ourselves. And it's God who really knows what's going to make us happy, what's going to bring us fulfillment, what's going to bring us satisfaction. That loving guidance of that loving God is given to us so that, you know, you're really going to live a better life if you live this way. Here and now. Ain't just fire insurance. Asaph continues the words of God. To the arrogant I say, boast no more. To the wicked, do not lift up your horns. Do not lift up your horns against heaven, nor speak defiantly. Now, let's say the tree of horns. You know, the Israelites were basically an agrarian society, and we're familiar, of course, with the animals around us. And hunting is big in this part of the country, sheep farming, cattle farming. And they were surrounded by sheep and goats and oxen, all various species of wild deer. And the horns of an animal are weapons. They're both used for offense and they're used for defense. Goats especially, we've all seen goats play king of the hill. Don't know why they do it, it's just instinctive. We see, you know, they get on top, and they keep butting their horns together, knocking the other off. And you know, we've all been around goats, and you know, they have a tendency to butt everything, including people that happen to be the head of them. All been bumped every once in a while. Those horns, they can be dangerous, those horns can cause damage. The imagery of the horn, especially into an agrarian society, is a sign of pride, it's a sign of strength. The animal with the horns is the one that's strong. They use that for power. That's what the imagery is implying here. Don't lift up your horns. Don't puff yourself up. Don't think you're greater than God. You know, there's an old expression I heard. I used to hear the mother used to tell it. I don't forget who it was, but my friend's mother, she would say, you know, don't tell me how good you are. Other people will tell me for you. So we don't lift ourselves up. God is in charge. The words that the pride, the honor, the self, in our New Testament lesson, the lesson that Jesus says, is those who humble themselves will be exalted, and those who exalt themselves will be humble. Take the lowest of us. Be the servant of all. After all, it was Christ who washed the disciples' feet. We praise God that he is greater than we are. And that the arrogant and wicked cannot prevail, even when we're the ones that are being the arrogant and wicked, and we sometimes do. Asaph writes, no one from east or west or from the desert can exalt themselves, it is God who judges. He brings one down and exalts another. In the hand of the Lord is a cup foaming wine mixed with spices. He pours it out, and all the wicked of the earth drink it down to its very dregs. It's God who gives the blessing and the evil tries to use it for their own pleasure. But it is God. And we praise that we are not judged by the inconsistent and destructive standards of this world. God made you and knows you better than you know yourself. He loved you so much that he came down from heaven, became fully human, lived the full human life, start to finish, birth to death, even death on the cross. He experienced all its ups and downs. Then he took your debt of sin and paid your debt in his blood. We praise God that he is a loving king who has died for the good of his subjects. He is the father who looks for the prodigal to return. praise God that He gives us His wise and loving guidance so that we may enjoy and have that abundant life now and in the age to come. Asaph concludes, "As for me, I will declare this prayer. I will sing praise to the God of Jacob." He says, "I will cut off the horn of the wicked, and the horn of the righteous will be lifted up." So we sing praise to God for all the blessings that He has given us. And He continues to give. Sing praise to God who is mightier than any evil this world or the devil or anything else in this fallen corrupt creation can send against you. Praise God who executes justice, and when His righteousness finds us at fault, accepts our repentance, cleanses us of our guilt. Praise God who holds the pillar of the earth every time when it's shaking all about us, that solid rock on which we stand. Praise God for His everlasting mercy that rescues us from sin and gives you always that second chance to become exactly what He created you to be. I will sing praise to the Lord for He is good, now and forever. Almighty God, we praise You, we stand in awe and honor You. We love You. We thank You that You are God, pure and holy and righteous, who loves us more than we can ever understand. Clean our hearts, O Lord. Clear us of our fear, our anger, our hate, that we may ever enjoy Your praises. Amen. As we prepare to go before the throne of grace in our congregational prayer, our song of reflection is, "Holy Spirit, Thou art welcome in this place." You may remain seated as we sing. Continue to cleanse us from within. Cleanse our hearts, O Lord. Give us the heart of Christ, the heart of love, that we may truly be Your disciples. Clear away the slag that we continue to accumulate, those walls that we build between each other, between us and You. Clear away our bent to sin in, those temptations that fall in our path that we give in to over and over again. We praise You, O God, for all the good gifts that You've given us, and especially for forgiveness. We know that we are weak. We are fearful. We give in to pride. We give in to greed. We give in to all kinds of temptations. Help us to continue to grow, Almighty Father, that we may be Your people, that we may lead our community and our state and our nation into revival, that they may know of your love, that they may know of Your peace, that they may know of Your forgiveness. We ask for leadership that is wise and compassionate. Bless all those in the seats of power, and give them Your guidance, that we may truly be led into one nation under God. We We pray for those that are working hard to keep our society moving, the first responders, the protect us in all kinds of ways, the stand between the law enforcement, the fence between us and chaos, the firefighters protect our life and property, the EMS that comes to us in times of injury. We pray for those that keep our roads open, the utilities going, the truck drivers that keep products moving, the merchants that keep products on the shelf. We pray for this ability to share your bounty, your creation, to improve the quality of all your people. We pray for our school. We pray for our teachers and students, for their protection and their guidance, that they may continue to seek truth. We pray for our military that stand between us and the chaos and those that wish to do us harm. We pray for those who are suffering from illness and injury. We pray for their recovery, a great physician. Pray for those that are facing surgeries and treatments and diagnoses that bring fear and trepidation. We pray that your presence be with all those, that your peace may be with them, that they realize that your blessed assurance, that you are with them through all the things that matter, that they can lift up and still give you praise. Almighty God, we pray for those that are lost in confusion and chaos, those that are suffering economic hardship. We pray for those that need you the most and those who think they need you the least. We thank you for the rain that you sent to refresh the earth. We thank you for the greening and the life that we see in the hills around us. Continue to bless us with life-giving rain. Mighty God, for those things that we ask, and those things we don't know we're supposed to ask, we lift them and place them into your hands.